Okay, good morning.
You want to introduce yourself? Okay, it's Hayen. Did I pronounce that correct? Hayen. Mm-hmm. Okay, he's the creator of the Nuitka software, which is a static Python compiler. And yeah, I suppose he's talked with me about that. Yeah, thank you.
Sorry about that. So thank you for coming this morning. I am indeed going to talk about the Python compiler that I created. I am going to make much of this a demo, so I'm going to actually show you the thing, walk you through. Last year I had a talk where I explained why am I doing this, why didn't I join some of the other projects out there, so I kind of gave my mission statement there. Now you're going to see more of what is going on and less of why it is going on. To briefly introduce myself, I am a project manager, software engineer in the ATC industry. I work for safety relevant products, and I have been working for Python for maybe 9 years now, and for a long time I have been thinking that something like a Python compiler should be possible, but I was always wondering why it was not going to happen. So one day I started doing it. So I'm going to explain a bit what Nuitka is, what requirements there are, and then we're going to go into demo mode. I will show you how to compile a simple program and what gets out of it. So you will see some more insight than just, okay, it's now compiled and then it's running. A simple module, because that's the other use case. So many of us are creating programs, but many of us are going to create modules and packages for delivery. Then next up, we're going to compile a full-blown program. Because when I say it's a Python compiler, the first thing that people are asking, what is it that it cannot do? And I'm here and presenting a state where, well, it's everything that it can do. There is nothing that is not supported, except for extremely esoteric cases. For example, I won't have bytecode objects in my functions anymore because they're compiled, these kind of things. But all the language, everything is working. It's very important part of a message. I didn't want to create a compiler that would be fast with some programs, but people are telling me they take it, they use it, works. And Mercurial is written in Python. For those of you who don't know it, it's a Git alike. And I don't use it much, but I use it for testing. So it compiles Mercurial, and the test suite of Mercurial is then passing, largely. Where in some places it's assuming that Mercurial is a script. So then we follow a design throughout the source. Done some quick run through of the goals. I did a part of that now. And give you a status update. Basically, everything that you use is supported. All the platforms that you use and don't use are supported. So one big thing actually, where I have to thank the Stackless people and other people who work with me, that is I'm working in a safety environment and we're not allowed to use threads. So I have no clue what Python threading actually really is, how it works technically and how to do that. And the Stackless people picked me up, explained me things and showed me the Jill and how that impacts things. So threading is supported now too. And I want you to join me because I do this as a spare time effort. There's only so much I can do and I would like to see this app pick up more velocity even. Next one, interesting stuff. When I worked on these reformulations, making Python a simpler language in Python, is part of the simplicity of creating that compiler. So I will show you some of the new stuff I have there and briefly touch on what there is. And next thing, well, a lot of this talk grows out of what I have discussions last year and this year at EuroPython, And these are kind of reactions to what you said, what you asked. So what if that happens? So actually the first thing people think that you can't create a compiler in Python because you can change anything. So I'm going to try and address that a bit. Then I'm going to show optimization, what there is now. It's not much that there is now in terms of largely effective. So this is mostly people optimization, dead code, and we're trying to avoid half frames, which are very expensive. And I'm going to talk about things that I'm have coming. So I was having a holiday in Cyprus, and now I have, if that means anything to somebody, single state assignment states, and I now can do more sophisticated standard compiler techniques. So actually what I had for a long time was just a Python to C++ translator. Then I added people optimizations, and now I'm at the stage where Python is just another thing like Java, C++, or anything, and I can start and apply standard techniques. You can read up on these in Wikipedia, and Nutka will just be implementing these, and large speedups are expected from that, of course, where right now the speedup that we have is mostly avoiding small things, avoiding the CPython runtime where it is possible. It's just an acceleration so far, which is strictly needed for the cases where you do not have optimization. So these are my goals. I was thinking out of the box, so in the theme of talks that we had, keynotes, I think, thinking out of the box, and I'm trying to address one of the issues that Mr. Lindberg from the Python Software Foundation told us about, is that Python may not be suited for everything. There's now Go, Lua, and other languages coming up. And I want Python to not accept that Python is only for scripting. I told you I'm working in this environment in the ATC, and we're using Python there for really important stuff. But Python naturally has to be limited because there is no compiler. You have to change the language and do things in another language if you want to be fast. And I want to take Python, which is easy to use, easy to learn, easy to apply, but still have fast code coming out of that. And I do not want to make any sacrifice at all. I want it to be Python. So no compromises were allowed. I'm supporting each and every stupid word of Python in exactly the same way. I don't have much time pressure, although the project is proceeding quite good. I think I have tremendous progress to show, but I tend to want to do things the correct way. So I could accelerate some things now in certain ways, and then I would have faster programs now, but I know that later on in the plan I will do it the right way, do this SSA-based optimizations, and that would be void. So I try not to waste my time, so that's part of how I try to proceed in a quick way. I have chosen this maybe strange name to you. It's a bit Russian. My wife is Russian, and she's named Anna. And the Russians have this tendency to not use the real name, but to somehow decorate it. So I'm Kai, but they would call me Kayunok. And that's and for her, it's Anyutka, or short form band again, Anyutka. So I named it after her. Some people give flowers to their wives, and I one day gave her a compiler. So that's what you get when you marry a geek, right? So it's working basically as an accelerator. So that was an important thing, to cover all of Python and the tediousnesses of the frame stack and compatibility with inspect module and everything. That was a large part of the work. Also some work that I was expecting, well, nobody wants to do it, but I quite have enjoyed it because it's a kind of a puzzle thing. There's always the one thing like super without arguments, how does it tell the class it is living in? Which is kind of an embarrassing hack of CPython that I now have to emulate. And I kind of enjoy these puzzles. So it's working on Linuxes, NetBSD, FreeBSD. I did it for fun, mostly for support of these, but also because I got some feedback there. And actually FreeBSD, some people are using it on their web servers. So with Nutka, I have to say. Then Windows 32 and 64 bits, Mac OS, so, and you can cross-compile. And I kind of do that because it allows me, because I'm not a Windows guy, more of a free software guy, do Windows for gaming, but you know, with a cross-compile, I can test Windows too. So Android and iOS, some people tell me that Kiwi, which has a presentation, I think, in parallel right now, is compilable, and the cross-compile to ARM, that may take more work, but ultimately there's a high interest there that Nutka could be used to accelerate Python on the phone, which is of course a low resource thing, and actually performance tends to matter there more. So I expect that to be possible, and we will see over the weekends there will be sprints. We will look into that. So I've chosen, starting last year, I've chosen a very liberal license, something which is floating on the internet. Initially I used a license which basically was a non-incentive to fork, so I put it under GPL. But I maintained the GPL for the created binary source. No longer doing that, it's absolutely free now, you can use it for whatever you want. But I wanted to have a sunrise phase. I was very scared of the idea that I was working on this, got it almost right, and somebody would pick it up and run with it and make it fast, and I couldn't compete with it anymore, and then it would again be only a halfway solution. So I was very willing to take the risk of getting less contribution there rather than not achieving these very important goals. But already last year that goal was achieved, and I put it under this very liberal license, and it's now use it commercially, do all the bad things. So these are the Python versions. I was supporting 3.2 already, and since recently 3.3. I do it mostly because some people who try out Nutka are bleeding edge users, so they tend to play around with a new Python, and it got me better test coverage. So the CPython community has a lot of tests, but I'm using their test suites to use Nutka, but tests only get added to the newer version. So when I ran the 3.3 test suite, I did find bugs, which of course also affect 2.6. Some things they recently noticed, there is some uncertainty, and added some tests. You need a C++ compiler. I'm going to show there has been some change as well. A lot more compilers than last time. It used to be only GCC and C-Lang, and now the Microsoft compilers are working as well, which was some work. And it takes your Python code. That is it. So demo time, this is the source of a program that we are going to use. It's just a simple function and a simple generator and something like these. And so, let me check here. Hold on. Actually, they are the same, but just to show you that. So that is it. Nutka is, when you download it, unzip it, it does not need any installation setup or anything. You just execute Nutka Python and it would try and behave the same way than Python. That was the idea. Mostly it takes it, compiles and executes it. It doesn't accept the Python flags yet, but the idea is that there should be a drop-in replacement to Python. So it ran already. And it's doing the same thing as that. And to help me do test, I get away with just comparing outputs. So if you have a look at my basic tests, I would do some things in Python and print it and do representations, do something, catch exceptions, print trace specs and so on. And that would be my test. So I'm very lucky, and that's what probably part of why I can do this project is that the testing is really a free gift, because CPython already has extensive tests, and with my my being compatible, I can use the Mercurial test suite as a test. If it still passes, I can I have no problem with availability of tests, and can make very simple tests which just print out things. So that's basically a test. And now let me show you what this did. So when we ran this, it produced a directory, which is the .py remove and .build, and created a bunch of files. The actual build is performed with sconce, but you don't really know that. You don't care. Nutka hides sconce from you. I know a lot of people think a sconce is a totally wrong thing and something that should be despised, but it's very lightweight and easy for me, and I'm embedding it for the Windows platform. It's very, it does the job. And what Nutka produces are the CPP files here, and this is the static part that is code that doesn't change, which is part of Nutka, and some header files. So why don't we look into the created module code? So I'm here, I put the liberal license, which makes it clear that you can do whatever it wants. Code is only in part my copyright, but I give you the license to do whatever you want with it. So does a few includes. We have here some global definitions. Global variables have a class. And we have here some func, some generator. The functions are variable names. There's code to create them. And here we enter already the implementation of one of these functions. So the function object itself and a parameter is given in the implementation. We have here a variable. It's a special class. It's a local parameter variable that is not ever deleted. It gets its name and a variable. And the actual code, if we check that, it's assigning 7. So I can use this object, assign 0. It's about reference counts. A huge part of the problem is to keep reference counts correct. So there's assign 1 and 0. And it's assigning a pre-made constant, Python impose 7. So that's the 7. Then here I'm having something which caches the frame object, which is quite a bit in our face. I would like to hide that one day in a macro. So here we have a frame added. So now we say, yeah, we are in function F. And inside here, we're telling this frame the line number. And here we have a statement on line 3, which will use a variable and do a binary add operation and do it. So I don't want you to go too deep yet into the into how this looks. I'm going to explain that later. Here I have some exception handling. So should a Python exception occur? I'm using C++ exception, where a Python exception will occur. So binary operator add could, for example, raise an exception, say, oh, I can't add these things. And that would be caught here. The frame traceback would be created. The locals would be set, and we would return to Python, or if it doesn't, return to Python. So that's the implementation. Then we have here a parameter parsing. So this one is the abstract thing, which gets keyword and tuple, and iterates over the dictionary, finds things, asserts things, raises errors, and does the compatible error messages. The error messages change them to Python 2.6, 2.7, 3.2, 3.0, so there's a lot of things going on here. This is statically generated code, so it's a bit faster than what Python does, obviously, because it is dedicated code. And for the case where there's only positional arguments, you can code also accepts a argument list as a series of pointers. I did that recently. It's making things very fast. In which case, I can directly call the implementation with the first argument, which means no parsing at all. So the above code that I showed you, which is iterating over dictionaries and so on, each time in Python you call a function, lots of things are happening. But if it doesn't have keyword arguments, things get a lot simpler. So that was the normal function. Then for generators have a context. I need a place to store the context, so let's look back at the code. This variable x that we get as a parameter to the generator, we need a place to store it. And then each generator instance needs its own context where it will reference it. So x is shared between all generator instances that get out of that. So there's something which will create the generator. This is the generator context. So that's when the generator is actually running. It will use the context and take local variables from there. For example, now it will access x from here. And for example, the yield becomes a yield. There's a helper function which will yield, does these kind of things, checking for exceptions at entry and so on. It's quite similar thing. And the creation of it is only slightly different. It creates a generator instead of a function, but otherwise it is rather simple, and it will copy the x here. So you get that kind of code, and the same thing repeated. There's quick entry points, there's parameter parsing, there's function creations here, and at the module level it would look like this here. So when we enter a module, there's a lot of things. We might be a module. In case we're a module, we need to initialize our runtime. There's some unfreezer that may be used, so you can in a module or in an executable, you can embed other modules, and then it will register itself as a importer. We create a module object, fairly standard one, and then we do some other magic. More magic, and here we have actual module code where we set module variables, for example, doc file, what is that, some func and some generator are being set here to the created functions, and then we're going to print it. Print item 2, null means standard out. And so a module is very similar. And that's already basically it. There's a runtime initialization. So this is here used to transport flex. So you could disable the random hashing and it would honor that, or it wouldn't. So you can still decide all the Python flex. I'm just not giving you the interface. I'm doing the site module import myself. And initialize my stuff. And then I call the main module. This is here. So that's basically a quick run through how this works, the Python to the C++. Behind that, you have compiled types. So what we end up with these functions that you saw are ultimately used by something called compiled function. And the compile function will then be very compatible to the Python function and behave like a Python object. So let's go back to that overview. There's other things here. For example, a lot of help of code is created on demand. So for example, a helper function to create a tuple of size 1, a helper function to create a tuple of size 3, 4, 5, list of 0, dict of 0, dict of 1, whatever is needed there, and a helper function to call a function with one argument. Used here. So it avoids now the tuple building. So that's basically it. There's some code here which provides constant objects. So these are all pre-created and initialized here in, well, from stuff. And I prepare code objects and so on. So that's to give you an idea of how this technically works. So we can use this, run this, and just be faster than before. This is essentially, what you're seeing there is essentially only about avoiding having bytecode and interpreting bytecode at runtime, and mostly then implementing the bytecode, rolling it out as C++ code, and being faster. You can be, you can gain quite a bit from that, and then you can apply more tricks, and this is getting us up to a 2.5 speed up of PyStone. So that's the accelerator part. So yeah, you probably saw that in the demo code. I have his typical name, main check. So what Nutka will be able to do is, if we have a module, we know that the name of a module is demo, and that's not, doesn't equal main, and we can throw away branches. So when I now compile the module, it works like this. Nutka without a Python is not the thing which immediately, I did wrong. Like this, it will give you the module, and the result is very similar. Actually, very similar. I'm also going to diff it. The differences are going to come from, now you see the module demo 2. Before it was under main, because whatever file name you choose, Python kind of remembers that file name in some attributes, but it doesn't use it for the module name of a main module, of course. But for here, we have now the two. And if we go down here, we get a module which assigns the created functions, but it won't execute the print statements, which were under a condition. So we're seeing here actually the name the name check got optimized away. There's no branch there, and it's either in there or it's not. And Nutka could does these kind of things with compile time constants. It's working quite well. So let's go to demo2.build. But if we do a diff of demo.build and demo2.build, that also can give a quick indication. You will see on the constant side certain things were changed. For example, we're not using the constant 42 anymore, and that is because it was only used in code that got removed. So that is basically it. And from there on, you get a bit of differences, but it's not much. So basically, that's the same thing. It's just another mode. To Python, being an executable just means you are a main module. So that is it. So that's a simple module. So I prepared something here. Yeah, exactly. I did here a command to compile all of Mercurial, which is this one here. So, and this is the result, and it took it 7 minutes to compile the whole thing, and end up with a binary that is not strictly small, but it's not huge either way, 25 megabytes. So clearly, we're making a trade-off. Binaries tend to be bigger than scripts. And we could use it. It's working. And here you get a bunch of warning. For example, it tells you that the statprof module, it couldn't find that email.parser something. It's not recursing to hgx. And it's suggesting you how to fix that. It found the AGX module actually, and you would just supply it like this, and it would include it too. That's the extension modules of Mercurial. Mercurial works as a sort of a plugin, and there you can include the plugins or not. I chose not to include the plugins now, but it would work as well. So that is Mercurial, and we can have a look into Mercurial, because then it gets a bit more crowded. hg.build. So we have a lot more modules here. In fact, for everything that we included. And then we got more stuff, more functions, and so on. And most of these are, as you can see, often functions in Python tend to be very trivial. So, yeah. That much about it. If you have any question about that or would like to see something, that would be a good time.
I was wondering, how do you manage that, whether there is, for example, a virtual M, or have you ever tried to...
A what?
A virtual M.
Ah, virtual environment. People are trying to use a virtual environment. Actually, when I compiled, I was just using the environment that is in effect. So I am independent of virtual environment. The question was, virtual environment, does that have any impact? And I was just using a full-blown installation of Mercurial. So to compile your program, you would install it, and then you would compile it and use it. So there's no preparatory steps. You see, you do not get to tell Nutka how and where your program files live. And so you likely did that already to run it, and that is enough. So if you have a Python path set up, it will find the things and include it and just work. So virtual environment, I do have one issue with virtual environment, that is I try not to recurse into a standard library unless you tell me to. And I think in virtual environment I am not properly detecting yet what the standard library there is, because I kind of have to guess it from something, and I got the idea that I somehow might have something to improve that. Because if you compile also all of the standard library, it's probably not 7 minutes, but maybe 20 minutes. And it's maybe not what you wanted by default. But it's working. Yes, please.
Compile the standard library into a different library and then link your application to the compiled standard library.
Yeah, that works. The question was if you can compile the standard library and then use it. And in effect, you can use, you can compile packages, modules, many of them, and can put them into one thing, and then can import that. But you're losing, what I envision with Nutka, that something that's supposed to be happening, is that you have a whole program optimization. So when we import the OS module, and we're using two or three things of that, and the otherwise I can prove somehow, maybe not, but maybe I can prove that certain things are not used in the module, I can leave it away, or I can specialize to it. So if you're using OS path base name only with strings, I might be able to create a variant that only works with strings. And technically I am aiming more at a whole program optimization. but it's working for packages, and I have people who are using it for packages.
Do you use a makefile system? In other words, if one of the modules in that Mercurial was changed, yes. Do you have to recompile a whole lot?
Yeah. But I am using CC cache, and then it's quite fast from that on. But you can, as I'm doing the whole program optimization, even very local changes will tend to invalidate all of it. So it is, I can't promise you much, but 7 minutes for a build, I used to grow up in a world where you were building in the night. So, and this Mercurial is a substantially large project. Nutco itself will compile much faster with itself. It's not much of an issue. And Sconce has something, CC cache, and clearly you could do something. But it's also something you do not have to do that all the time, because one of my goals is that you can interchange. So you're using Python and the compiler, and the expectation modulo bugs of Nutka, or CPython in some cases, is that the behavior doesn't change. So that's probably not a step that you're going to do just to test something out. I'm not going to compile it. It's just to test my code. So, okay, another question. I'm going to repeat it anyway. Yeah, I will.
No problem.
Do you think it would be possible to leave features out of the compilation, like setting the line number of the line of code?
Yes, I have an option for that. I think there's not as much to gain there, I hope. If you're really good at compiling it, likely you're going to find most often that you do not have to set the line number, because no exception will be raised. Or if it will be raised, you will then use the precise line number. Right now, the code generates more in terms of a line number in a robust fashion, but I'm going to make changes that will allow the code to do that a lot less. But I do not envision much options in terms of, okay, I want to be incompatible and then I'm somehow better. With line numbers, I can see that perfectly. Well, they're not as important to everybody. Many people do not want to see their users any stack traces. So yeah, that's something I will do. But there's not going to be a lot of that. I'm saying that now. So yeah, okay. If you look at the generated code, and I was thinking it was about readable yesterday, but I'm not so sure now. Where I said I don't want you to look, now you may look. This is a print statement. And one of the things that you have is C++ doesn't help you with enforcing the order of evaluation. So I have this helper here, binary operation and. You see here and here, two of them. There's two of them. And the arguments, if I just put global variable B, dereference it, and global variable A, it would do it in the wrong order. And potentially, because the C++ standard doesn't guarantee me something. Last year, I had a trick where I just changed around uses and definitions with some defines. And I have a slide on that, how I'm now doing it with sequence operators. So I now put the value beforehand in here, and I'm using this thing in brackets to assign it. So that's a trick I am using, which kind of harms the readability. The readability will come back as soon as Nutka can know that A and B and D are not cannot raise. So what could happen is that it will say A name error doesn't exist. So I have to check for that. And that is why I have to maintain the order of evaluation. If A and B both cannot raise, their order is not relevant. And then I can use the simple code again. So with the work I'm doing now, I in most cases will be able to do that, and this should be the exception. But right now, in order to support a Microsoft compiler, which is apparently taking, well, it's doing it in the correct way, and it's taking its liberty to rearrange the function call parameter creation as it sees fit. I was not getting away with that simple trick, so I got to improve it. But yeah, it still kind of resembles what you had. There's a conversion to string for print, and there's a new line printing here. I have here a couple of comments. I'm using C++ to help me with the object references. For example, I here get a result, and I do not get to keep the result, but instead I just convert it to a string, which I do not keep. I only use it to print, and the PI object temporary is something that will just accept the object, give it out, and delete it for me automatically afterwards. So I try to keep the code generation simple still, although I think it's kind of degraded with the with this, but it was necessary. But the idea is that the code, the generated code, still has to be readable, or we won't be able to fix it. So obviously, if I knew that A and B are numbers and so on, I would use not pi objects. Working with pi objects will be this complex. Working with numbers, I suppose, will be a lot simpler code. So, this one, you can't see it, I suppose. You were not supposed. So what I wanted to do was also to walk you through how the whole thing looks. And I did that in the demo. So you have your code on the top. Your code, you put it into Nutga. It outputs this kind of build directory, which is then handed over to Sconce, which is calling the C++ compiler. And there's two ways. You have an executable or you have a module. So kind of did that. I have it in the presentation still because you can download it and then you can read it. And here we have something which I want to walk you through and show you some things. That's how it internally works. And I thought it would be better than improving this would be to show you the main flow. And to follow it through so we basically what we're doing here is we create a tree, which with some certainty is going to give you a syntax error or indentation error, which we're handling and doing some nasty things. Then we might dump it, or we could ask the main control to compile it. Afterwards, we get to remove it. There's something coming up, which is called the portable mode, which I likely will present next year. It's not finished yet. That would be Py2exe. Not only do you get to compile an executable which works on your machine, but you get to take it to another machine and run it, and it works out of a box. It is kind of halfway working, but I chose to disable it for releases so far because I do not want people to be disappointed where it doesn't work. And I know there's a lot of interest there. And yeah, it might want to execute it immediately. So that is it. And the main control, when it creates something, it will ask the builder, build me a node tree from a file name. So we go there. And this is doing some tricks. There's a lot of conventional stuff about packages and so on. So you need to check if it's a file, is it a directory, is there a main PI, init PI, is it a package, is it a module? Kind of makes things different, but you build a parse tree. And building that parse tree, Python already has built into itself something very important. It can understand and parse Python. We're using it. And from there on, we're just working on that. So let me check let's look for call. No, not call. Yeah, for example, a dictionary. So it has node keys and values. I build a list of keys, I build a node of values, and that's my node. So I'm building an internal representation of things from the abstract syntax tree. Most of the time it's very simple. The cases that are here are the ones not reformulated. For example, with statement, it's going to be more complex, and I'm going to show you that. So that is a building phase. Then we go into optimization. Optimization means we have nodes, and I'm going to do that later. We go into optimization and finalization and code generation. So that's the inside view. So returning to my goals, this is quite an important time where Nutkin is now. We are now going to get much faster. We didn't lose anything. We still have auto-completion, syntax highlighting, pylwill still work, dependency graphs, and so on. Should Nutkin not work for you, you can still use PyPy, you can Jython, CPython, IronPython. You can still switch. There's no lock-in. And I didn't want to create anything where when it has a bug, you're screwed and can't run your code. So this is something I suggest. I'm cutting short on these ones. I used to use C++ 11, but it turns out it got me quickly off the ground, so I had something running very quickly. But in order to get the details right, I kind of used less and less of these features because, for example, evaluation order for template arguments is the same thing. So I kind of had to give up on these things and do my own stuff in C++ 03. Which makes it easy to support everything else. Function call arguments here. In Python, you're guaranteed that first you call A, B, and C. In C++, you're not, so that is why you get to do it this way. So the project, I have a huge emphasis on stability, so I'm using the Git flow. And I have a release that I always believe to be in perfect shape or make a hotfix release soon after. I've not made a hotfix release in quite some time. So the test coverage is, as I told you, it's quite easy to get a good test coverage. And so not a lot of things are found. There's a develop branch, which are future releases where improvements will be seen. I have a factory branch where I put out things. For you, if you report something, want something, get something, I put it in factory and let it live there for a while and still do rebases of it because I use that already to track down regressions, especially, for example, in performance. It would be nice to use Git bisect and always have a working state. And therefore, I try not to push things into master and factory that break something. So I let things, feature branches used to be used, but I stopped doing that. I just move the whole thing ahead with multiple goals. So where are we? Feature parity. Well, there's a lot of tricks. I'm patching the inspect module, for example, so it accepts a compiled module as a function as well. I provide a patches. Threading is supported, so we have feature parity. So generate efficient C++ code. The PyStone, this number may even be better now. I didn't rerun it yet. I know that I improved it by 10% with the last release. 10% compared to Nutka, so might be 25% more or something here. But I'm very bad at numbers. This is my spare time project. I can make a decision either I code or I write about it test it or I make benchmarks. And so far I'm only using benchmarks where they benefit me in my actual work. So users, you always want numbers here, compare it and everything. What is it now? And I'm more interested in what's the next thing that I should do. And benchmarks are not yet helping me when I know I need to have, for example, a simple state assignment and eliminate dead code, which is probably not very benchmark effective, but structurally it's a very important progress. So we have faster function calls. That was one area which I recently discovered where Nutka was even slower than CPython. Actual calls with only positional arguments used to be slower, but now they are faster. And these kind of things may happen. Exceptions are, per design currently, slower because C++ exceptions are slow. So I will have to work on that some more. It does constant propagation, but the people optimization, it will do at some point type inference. That's only starting to exist. So creating dedicated code for lists, integers, and so on, you can be a lot faster if you do not treat everything as a Py object, but if you know that something is a list, and you can quite easily know it's a list because it got assigned from a list, and then you call append on it, what Nutka currently does, it looks up the attribute append and makes a call, and that's all stupid, because obviously, and there's low-hanging fruit for optimization there. Then another thing that's very important is the interfacing with C code. I think one of the areas where I hope to see adoption of Nutka is to turn the C bindings into pure Python again. So there's the Cython project, which makes you do a hybrid C and Python thing, and then it's no longer pure Python, and it gives you some speed up, but you cannot really analyze it as a whole program afterwards anymore. And I want people to write pure Python bindings. We in the company, we do pure Python bindings, and Nutka should become able to do calls. I have a slide on that later. And to give us hints, so when you know something is going to be in some way, but Nutka doesn't understand you, ultimately you should be able to provide it with hints. So interfacing to C, here's an example of how C-types works, in case you don't know it. You load a function from a library, then access a function by name, and you tell what are the result types, the argument types, and then you can just call it with standard Python types, and it will do the conversions. So that's the ideal interface for Nutka to use. And you could create code which will just do the right thing and call it in C without any speed loss. The idea is that if Nutka understands C types well enough, you could create bindings with zero overhead. That is the goal. That's the promise of the future. So current activities, the SSA-based optimization, proper handling of SSA, so there's still some work there. I can't really release it yet because there are cases where it works, but there are still cases where I still have to make it recognize that there are some merges and it can't do anything anymore. The CPython 3 test suite, it's running almost unmodified now. I have it running, but I didn't publicize it yet because it's only one commit. But it's a relatively small commit. It's very little things that now you need to change to run it with Nutka. Very, very little. And only expected things. For example, I do not have a bytecode attribute, that kind of things. So I would like to do more performance data. Actually, what I meant to say was I need you to join me, and one way of joining me would be to help me and expand the reach of benchmarking Nutka. So if there was somebody who wanted to benchmark Nutka with a shed skin tests, which should be very well suitable for me, that would be great. So let's look at this, because that's interesting stuff. Classes. So on the upside, we have a class definition. And when I started out, I actually had it for some time. I had dedicated code for classes, I think even last year. And now I no longer have that because I do a reformulation. So here you start a pseudo function, make some class, which at the end returns locals and does some standard assignments. And I have this here. to make it clear, if you do that, locals becomes writable in Python. So you could use locals update and change a class, and so that's basically what it means. So a class definition ends up being just function calls for Python. That is a big relief. Or for example, one thing I've been pondering for a long time, I had three things. I had the OR expression, I had the AND expression, and I had the conditional expression. I had all of these three, and I was always under the idea that somehow the conditional expression should be some form of AND and OR. But it turns out it's actually the other way around. So OR is a ternary expression. It's the left hand if it is true, or it's the right hand. And the AND expression is the right hand if the first expression is true, otherwise it's the left hand. So that was a huge discovery, and that makes me only have one case. So I did many, many others of these. For example, while loops, on for loops, I made the mechanics of a for loop explicit. So I would take a temporary and assign the iterator, do a next on it, try and catch the stop iteration and break the loop if it happens. With statements, we enter or exit, temporary variables, function calls, try and exit. Decorators are function calls on the temporary variable of the function. In place, complex, unpacking assignments. It's all simple assignments with keeping temporary variables. So that leaves you with a much simpler language internally. There is no else if. Even if you look at the parser output, that's just nested if statements. Else if is just a sugar candy. There is no else in try blocks. So try finally else, try accept else. You can just keep a flag and check it after the statement if it was executing a handler, and if it is not, you execute that else block. Contractions are just a nice way of writing functions. Generator expressions are no different from generator functions without a name. They are named, well, genex, but that is it. You do not get, it's not a statement to define them, it's an expression, but basically it's the same thing. And complex calls, that's also something I learned in the last year. I had a call which had a large complexity with keyword arguments, this and that. It turns out I can rather make helper functions which combine the complex call arguments with the other arguments. And then I just have calls that use a tuple and a keyword dictionary. So actually, if you want to read that, I have on the website, I have a developer manual, and here you can read, and I recommend you do that, this chapter, for example, that's something I presented last year too, the assert, there's no assert statement, it's just a conditional check and erase of the assertion error exception. That's, so there's no, I used to have a node that was an assertion node, and I used to generate C++ code for that, but now I no longer do. So much of the work was focused around that. So, but what if built-ins change? So I have this code here that already tells you that. What if every time you write to a built-in, you come by and you'd come by here. So I'm going to see you. And for example, if you change the open, I would tell my code, oh yeah, this is the new value of open, use it. And I can also raise a runtime error if you want to update len. I'm not doing that yet. So when I see len and it's not written to, so I know it's a built-in value, then I'm just doing my quicker len. But that is under the assumption that you didn't change it. And what I will do is, for these where I'm making the assumption that you do not change them, and you must not change them without me noticing, when you escape me for some reason, I would raise a runtime error and just give up. So that's not not much of an issue. Then the other thing is that values escape. Anything could change. Yeah, but as long as I can make these checks quick. So in checking and see that a global variable is unchanged. Right now, it would be a dictionary lookup, and it would be expensive for me. But I have already a code which does this built-in module, and with that, I can be sure that I see every write to the module, even if it comes from foreign code, which might be not compiled because it comes from a file and gets executed. Exec, for example, is also well supported. If that code does that, I get to see it and I get to change a flag and the code will then fall back to slower versions. So what I think Nutka is largely about is about gracefully degrading performance. So the more dynamic you get, the more unexpected things you do, you fall back in performance. But I don't know about your code, but my code, I use a meta class here and there, but I don't do much nasty things to stuff. So I think a global analysis may optimize most of my code correctly. And if that's not happening, I'm going to give a warning to the user, to the output, to some log, and tell you, look, this is kind of surprising, but it happened. You may want to give me a hint about it. So, or you may want to prevent that or change that. So I think that can work. As I said before, please join me. I think this is what I didn't do when I started the project, I was not going to the CPython mailing list and ask about it. So I didn't ask for permission to do the project. I didn't receive much forgiveness yet. So the thing is, this is something that a lot of people think is too difficult to exist. It should not be done, it's useless, and so on. But it's my thinking out of the box. I want to promote Python into areas where it is not currently. And I would love if somebody joined me and helped the course. I'm going to do the integration work. I'm going to accept whatever patches. And only if you try it out and find things that don't work, that's very valuable input already. So please do that. So what I have right now, and I want to show you these things, how they look in code, so you get an idea that, this is a super difficult project, I could never be part of it. Actually, I'm kind of one person said I'm stupid. So it's not all rocket science. It's more of an overly complex puzzle. It's just a tremendous amount of work in the details, but then there's a lot of things which are just not done. So, for example, if we go to statement nodes, so for every statement, we visit every module and the function it defines and references, and then the modules it imports. And inside each scope, we then iterate over all the statements in the order they are executed, potentially making branches, and the branch is represented by this object constraint expression. And then, for example, this is the assignment attribute expression, so it's now the right time to evaluate that expression, which afterwards may have changed. So it will change in place, so I have to get it anew. And then I can check, does it have side effects? I will make these statements. If it is raising an exception, I can make that a raise statement instead, so you're no longer, if that expression, for example, raises an exception, it's no longer an attribute So if you look up an attribute that on something that already raises an exception, the attribute lookup is forgone. So you can just promote it up. So I produce here replacements for the statement, and I return it, and that is it. So every statement, attribute lookup, variable assignment, and so on, kind of does these things. So that's pretty well. If you look around, it's not too difficult. And let's go to attribute nodes. Yes. It's maybe more straightforward. Now we're doing an attribute lookup. And if it erases, we will just return that. Or otherwise, we will ask the source that we're doing a lookup, well, compute me what an attribute of lookup of that would be. So that's the peephole thing. And it's following the evaluation order. And at any given time, you have a certain state and can follow that. You can do, Nutka can do dead code elimination, empty branches get removed, but statements might be abortative. So if you have a conditional return, and when we notice, we know the condition is always true, then the code subsequent will get removed. Dead variables, removing that is coming with the SSA analysis. So frame stacks can be avoided. You saw that bunch of code I showed you in the Emacs, and that bunch of code contained a frame stack object, and creating a frame object is kind of expensive. I do some caching on it, but it still takes time, and if it's never needed, it's kind of disappointing to have it. So what it's been trying to do is it knows that this one cannot fail, and the return statement of that cannot fail because this is known to be assignment. And yes, then, well, we can forward propagate and so on. But if we know it cannot fail, we also know we can remove a frame. And frames are separate from functions definitions already. So you define a module, and the first thing there is in a frame. And a frame can shrink down to size zero independently, and also later, if we're going to inline function, the frame will be inlined as well. So for tracebacks, it will still know that it's in another frame, but there will be no actual function calls after the inlining. So that's a very good separation that we have there. And with SSA-based optimization, for example, this will become a function that cannot race, and then it will be very cheap to call, even cheaper. Right now, the SSA collects so-called traces. So when we enter a scope, we set up all the variables that we know are being used in a function to uninitialized, that would be a local variable, unknown, that's probably a global variable, and unless we do block analysis where we know, for example, that a global variable will be initialized, it will be unknown. And initialize, that's for example for parameter values. We don't know what the value is, but it is initialized. So we don't have to test if it's defined. And then we do this visit, the constraint collection I call that. And while we do that, we add references and so on. And every time there's an assignment taking place, we start a new version of a variable. And then when branches exit, for example, both of the if statement branches exit, you need to merge them. And then we have traces, and we can do a lot of optimization based on these traces. And I did some, I was very excited about that, to see this actually succeed and work with conditional statements now. And I need to teach it about loops and exception handlers, and then I think it might become usable. It will not be the major performance breakthrough, but the not raising, it will get us better ones. Escape analysis, We need to trace when escapes do happen, and when we know that values do not escape, either in the code generation we do not have to have guards against that, or we can have, for example, if you have a list that you only use locally, what CPython does, it allocates a list object, assigns it a reference count, and frees it. And then it has a certain memory layout, and you can work on that. And if you do that, and you know that that is bound to happen, we could you have something on the stack, which is not entirely a list, but just works like a list and is faster. So I want to go there and work faster with lists. This is more likely to have an impact on real existing code. So I think we can still do a couple of questions if you have collected new ones. I am here for all of the Python conference, and I'm having a sprint, which I think still has zero participants, actually, which is untrue, but I forgot to say that I participate, I guess. But maybe that's how it's designed. But you're welcome to come, and well, you're welcome to come now, but also on Saturday and maybe Sunday, a part of it. And ask questions and show your stuff, and I will try and get Jutka working for you with your code. I welcome questions and so on. So I would certainly like more contributions. I'm getting some, but not enough. And to fund my travel, I used to do, say, with all my effort, and I now started to accept donations, and I'm would it be happy to accept donations which, for example, cover my travel to something like EuroPython, as you all here probably know, is not entirely cheap trip. So I would also like you to do a critical design. And I get ideas from C++ people, maybe use some tricks. So that is it. So that presentation, yeah, I'm using RST to PDF and so on. So, yeah. Maybe some more questions.
Yeah.
Does it mean we have 4 minutes for questions, or does
no,
it mean?
No, doesn't mean that.
Yeah, I'm more question time.
10 minutes.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So if I wanted to distribute the binary, what would I need to bundle with it?
Yeah. Now you would have to have all the packages installed on the target system that you do not recurse to, and then the shared object files. So if there's some C code, for example for PyQt, you would have to have the DLLs installed. With the portable code, it will pick these up for you, put it in an archive, and attach it to the binary, much like Py2exe does. So in the future, it will be very simple. But right now, transporting to another machine is not really well. So it's not yet a method of distribution. But I see the need for that. People are telling me that Go does that a lot, and I think Python should have that as well, and it's quite easy, and I'm getting patches from other people, contributions actually, who do that. Yeah. Question.
Hey, with the frames, do things like PDB and coverage work? And Python tracer? Or
Tracing and profiling, you can use that, you can use a normal Python for that. And the tracing, I'm abusing it, and for my own purposes, I'm using that to give you quick tracebacks with Jutka, and no, you can't do that. So PDB and is not going to work, which is kind of a setback, but you can use the normal Python runtime and do all the tests and coverage with that, if you do coverage testing. Could do the functional testing, of course, with Jutka.
Okay, thanks.
How does Jutka compare to Cython, the tool, when you use it for compiling the pure Python program?
One guy did a compilation of PyStone, and if one is CPython, I think Cython was 0.8, and Jutka 0.4. And I have read a statement from one of the contributors, important contributors on the CPython mailing list, which said they're somehow not optimizing on purpose these things. So I don't think they care about pure Python performance. So if you have pure Python code, the first thing you will get told is, yeah, just add the type information, then it will be quick. And Nutka, if you don't do that, Nutka will be already quicker. And I think ultimately I expect to make something like Cython obsolete. Sorry.
Sorry, another question. What kind of global optimizations do you use for?
Right now, I only have the people stuff right now. I'm starting to use still a local optimization based on the SSA. And whole program optimization is just on my mind. It's a later step. I'm going to do whole module optimization for C types then, right? So, but crossing module boundaries, I'm not yet doing that, but in principle, doing function inlining across module boundaries it's not too far away from happening. There was a question too. It's okay.
So one of the reasons that Python is so popular is that it is used in web development.
Yeah, that's true.
So now imagine that I'm developing a Django application.
Yes.
Now I'm using, let's say, Apache with mod Python. Now I will have a binary, so probably I will have to switch to CGI or fast CGI to run your...
Why would you? Because a web server can embed Python, right?
Because now I have machine code and not the...
It's not strictly true. If you want, you do not have to have a binary. Being a binary is just one interface. You can be a package. I think to the server in VSGI, you probably are some Python module, aren't you? It's an interesting question. I will have to check that
another
but
problem.
I don't see a technical reason why you couldn't be called up from a web server. I know that people are doing Twisted and using that, for example, for video on the web and seeing performance speed ups with that. And I was thinking that was not... I don't think that is a hurdle, but maybe it's something that I should learn about. Yeah, can teach me.
But another problem I see is interfering with database drivers. Like if I have CX Oracle that has some C extensions.
Yes, they're working.
Yes, I know. But my question is, do you think they will work faster, they will work slower using the...
It won't accelerate Oracle. But it may accelerate the way you're calling the bindings of it. So if I ultimately down the line see, I don't know how they're making the C code, so maybe it's some Cython thing, but up to the point to where I can accelerate things, and I might be able to call that function even faster than C Python does. But there's only so much that, what I want to achieve for the ecosystem is that these boundaries go away, and for example, if the bindings of your module would be pure Python with the C types, if I could convince people, then it could be dramatically faster. It would be, you could have some of your parts of your program as if they were written in C and using the Oracle bindings. That could happen. We're not there, but I want us to get there in the coming years.
So, summing up, you think
I want to optimize the whole
thing. Still, will be a benefit. We've
not
using
now.
This full
not
feature,
now.
Okay.
Not now, but I'm. It's clearly one of my goals is that you can use C code and do not have overhead.
Okay, thank you.
Sorry.
Do you see any use in the function annotations?
Function annotation, I support them. I think they might make sense for hints. It's Python free, and we have to be honest, it is not relevant yet for much software. So I was thinking that I have skipped these slides. If you allow me, I have here... Can you repeat the question? Yeah. hints. What was I doing? It's not helping. I have this idea that you will just have an external module which will be coded in Python. And the external module, for example, you will say, hints, this module is not written from the outside. And then what will happen is that there's Python code which does make that sure. So it replaces your module with something that, I'm sorry, this is just looking bad, sorry. I'm replacing the Python module then with something which protects against writes. So it's happening at the Python time. And at the same time, what I will be aiming for is to teach Nutka to recognize, this module is isolated. The only user is not writing it. So I can assume that it's not written to. So that is how I want to do it.
Python library,
yeah.
Which makes sure that the compiler of Python remain compatible.
No. Actually, the opposite. The hints module is supposed to work with pure Python and do the same assertions and tests. It's supposed to work in pure Python already, and then the compiler, either it can use it as a shortcut, seeing that it knows what it does, and okay, or it understands the code, inlines it, and understands it. That is the two ways I would like to go there. So if you provide a signature to a function, I would do it with a hints module or something as well, and have Python code behind that, which makes sure that it's honored.
Can you, for example, as well use assert statements? So for example, there's assert x is instance integer?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, if you do that, the compiler will know it is an integer, and do that check, and from then on live happily with the knowledge. And you may put that in a hint, so it is probably it's going to give you a nicer error message than assertion failed, or yeah. So that is my goal there is to not make it a new language and to not make it something which is only working when the compiler is looking. So actually, I want that to be Python code because I find it generally useful to have these things. For example, you have this assumption that your module is not written to from the outside or only these variables, and you can enforce that. It works with Python, and I don't see, I see that it will become easier for the compiler when you do that. So thank you.
Another question. In the beginning you said that Nutka works on everything but a few extreme edge cases. Can you give us an example?
Extreme edge case. Okay, one bug that I currently am still having, one difference. For example, when it raises an exception, you have a function, it raises an exception. It will populate the frame locals then, at that point in time, but not before. So if you call a function and it wants to go upwards and check the locals, we'll find it empty right now. That is a compromise on performance that I made, and I have not yet found anybody who noticed that except maybe one CPython test. So it is, it's not, you do not look at the locals of something before the exception. That's apparently a true statement. Locals itself, it works. If you call locals, it will create the locals and update it and so on. So every time I catch you looking, it works. But yeah, that's one, or for example, there's a very fine difference in how temporary references are released. So if I call a function and the arguments are calling a function, and when they are calling a function, the order of releasing the references is not yet the same as it is in CPython, but I already know how to change that in, with these ordered evaluation code that I showed. So, well, you surely can catch it with very, very minor incompatibilities, but twisted, lots of things work with it very well. I do not know what is not working yet, so it's very, very minor things. I think you cannot change the default size yet. The code is now prepared to accept that, so you can assign a function default attribute to another one, but you cannot change the size yet, because previously my code was making assumptions about the defaults being there or not, optimizing for that. I'm no longer necessary to do that, and very, very minor differences. So when I publish the test suite, you will basically get an annotated diff of that. I have the other test suites published and modified, but a lot of these differences no longer valid. So it got improved, and I'm not changing them. So thank you for that.
What about threats? Does the compiled code suffer from some kind of global lock, or can multiple threads actually run?
Yes, it does. One of the test cases that is failing, and which is why I'm saying that threads are only some way supported, is that I'm making a nasty trick to support threading, and that is, I don't know, the CPython runtime works by looking at how much bytecode did I execute. It's enough. Now I am switching threads. And I don't have that. So what I do is at every loop iteration, I check for a counter and do it occasionally. And the thing is, if you do start a thread and then go to sleep immediately, I have seen one case where I deadlocked because my code was not doing something and the other one was not. That was somehow possible, but let's say 99% of the tests is working with this trick. I have a better plan for threading, which goes into the direction of multi-core usage. That is, I will have a controlling thread which monitors it all. So right now, each thread itself releases the GIL and manages the GIL. And I will have one thread which does the monitoring and uses global volatile flags. And the threads will indicate their need for it or non-need. And then this will be without overhead. And I can make it time-based and not at every loop check. So what I basically did now is kind of a workaround. That seems good enough, but it's not the ultimately best thing yet. But it seems nobody's noticing the difference in real applications. Yeah, go ahead.
Sorry, do you check signals as well?
Signals, test signals works. The Control C was one bug I had. So when you press Control C, nothing was happening in a compiled program. And actually, that was discovering how that works helped me discovering how I might do threads. So it's the same thing.
I was not from the beginning of the lecture, but
I can understand that. It was too early.
We know that the dynamic allocation and deallocation of memory in Python is managed by a garbage collector.
Yes.
And in a compiler that generates a compiled executable code, the garbage collector is part of the compiled code or is external to the compiled code?
I'm kind of using C++ for garbage collection where I can locally. And then I'm using the Python runtime mostly. So these are, I'm starting out with only Py objects. So I'm not yet using anything that is not a Py object. I'm not using int for what I know that is int. That's going to come. And then I'm not going to need garbage collection because these ones irrelevant, right? It's not happening. But it works with the garbage collection. But the tests for garbage collection are very dependent and sizes, they do check and so on. So garbage collection works, but for example, I know that I have a bug that a compiled function that references itself does not yet get garbage collection. So I do have kind of garbage collection bugs of minor significance, but it integrates with a Python garbage collection. So compiled functions are garbage collected. If you import a compiled module and you no longer use it, it gets garbage collected. So it's all.
Then your compiled code needs a Python environment.
Yeah, it's, absolutely. Without CPython, this project is nothing. Exactly. I need a CPython environment. I will try to avoid it as much as possible, and that's where most of the acceleration comes from. But it's always there to help me to do the exec statements or to interface with unknown code. So if I call anything, yeah, it's a Py object. I will ask. I will have an accelerated version of what the CPython runtime does that integrates well with it and does a call. So it is largely a CPython add-on. It's an accelerator. Should CPython be replaced by PyPy? I'm screwed.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. Yeah. I think there is the coffee break right now. I should be ready.